join the everlasting song. I sought the Lord, and He answered me and delivered me from every fear. And those who look on Him are radiant, and never be ashamed. Never be ashamed. This poor man cried, and the Lord heard me and saved me from my enemy. The Son of God surrounds His saints.
Good evening, and we're glad you're here to worship with us tonight at Macklin Baptist Church. Got good crowd tonight. Glad that you're out there listening. We're going to begin our services that has become something we really need to do in prayer. Do you know that the Lord's Prayer, the disciples' prayer in Matthew chapter 6, it begins and it says, "Our Father." Did you know that nowhere in the Lord's Prayer does it use I, me, or my? Interesting. Our Father, which art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. Why that? I've been around football for a long time. And I've been around folks that teams that have recited the Lord's Prayer. And even if you go about it slowly and think about what you're saying, it's about a minute long. Most of the football teams I've been around have said it like this: "Our Father which art in heaven, hallowed be thy name, thy kingdom come, thy will be done." And they don't even think about what they're saying. Our Father. Let's let that sink in. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. The greatest thing I can pray for you is for God's will to be done on earth in your life as it is in heaven, and you for me. We've made the Lord's Prayer such a, you ready for this word? Text message. We've made it a simple little, say it as fast as you can and not even think about the words of the prayer. The disciples said, "Lead us, teach us how to pray." You know why? Because they saw a connection between the time Jesus spent with the Father and the impact of his ministry. There's a connection. You think we might catch that connection? There's a direct link between the time I spend with the Father and the impact of the ministry that he's given to me. Father, we bow before you. You are our Father, which art in heaven. And we count it great privilege tonight to be children of the King. And we count it great privilege, but also great responsibility, to come before the throne and to bring to you our intercessions, our petitions, our praises, and to say, thank you, God, you've been good to us. Thank you, God, for what we experienced this morning. Thank you for the uplifting in our spirit that we could be together. Maybe we couldn't hug one another, but we were together. And Father, I pray that we'll not get used to just sitting at home and watching on a screen, but that you would prompt us that we're to assemble together. And as we go in these stages and assemble together, I pray, God, your people will come back to church, because we need that fellowship, that interpersonal relationships with each other. Father, here's our prayer tonight, that you'll be glorified in this service, that your name would be lifted high. We pray and we worship tonight in the name of Jesus. But we also pray, God, for every person under the sound of this preacher's voice. I pray that your will would be done on earth in their life and in my life as it is in heaven. And I pray in the name above every name. The scripture says he is the Alpha and the Omega, the beginning and the end, the first and the last. He was, he is, and he always will be. His name is my personal Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. And it's in his name I pray. Amen.
Amen. Thank you, Pastor Mike. We're excited again. Isn't it so good to be in the Lord's house? We've been doing this for a couple of weeks. We've just had to look at the pews. And, man, this is so refreshing to see men and women join together and to hear you sing. Tonight, we're going to sing about the greatness of God. We do serve a great God. Amen. So whether you're here in our sanctuary or whether you're at home, I invite you to stand with us as we sing this great song together about the great I Am. Let's reboot that. Mr. Eddie, can we go to the great I Am? There you go. Here we go. I want to be close, close to your side. So heaven is real and death is a lie. I want to hear voices of angels above, singing as one, hallelujah. Holy, holy God Almighty, the great I am, who is worthy, none beside thee. God Almighty, the great I am. I want to be near, near to your heart, loving the world and hating the dark. I want to see dry bones living again, singing as one, hallelujah. Holy, holy God Almighty, the great I am, who is worthy, none beside thee. God Almighty, the great I am. Amen. I love this part. The mountains shake before you. Let's sing it. The mountains shake before you. The demons run and flee. At the mention of your name, King of Majesty, there is no power in hell or any who can stand.
Said,
Amen. You can be seated. Could I share just a verse of scriptures? We think about the greatness of God. I love the passage in Chronicles where they've just brought the ark in, and David is assembled the folks together in a time of celebration. Listen what he says in Chronicles chapter 16, 1 Chronicles chapter 16. Oh, give thanks to the Lord. Call upon his name. Make known his deeds among the people. Don't you just love that? And I think that could apply to us today. Make known his blessings. Make known his deeds among the people. Then this is my favorite, one of my favorite verses. Sing to him. Sing praises to him. It's not a choice, the way I look at that. God commands us to sing praises to him. He doesn't tell us to sing in tune, which that's always a nice thing to do, to sing in tune. He just says, sing to him. Sing praises to him. Tell of all his wondrous works. Glory in his holy name. Let the hearts of those who seek the Lord rejoice. What a picture of worship. Amen. Let the hearts of those who seek him rejoice. Let seek the Lord in his strength. Seek his presence continually. Remember the wondrous works that he has done, his miracles and the judgments he uttered. Then in verse 25, for great is the Lord and greatly to be praised. Man, isn't that the truth? Think about the blessings. Hadn't God been good to you? Hadn't God blessed you in a great way? What I read in that, what God spoke to me, I need to share that. That needs to fuel my praise. Amen. Whether it's here in this sanctuary, or whether it's in my car as if I'm riding down the road, or whether it's in my fishing boat and I'm out fishing somewhere, or in the deer stand, it's about praising the Lord with everything that we have, because we serve a great and awesome God. Amen. There's a great, great song. I just love it. I just love this song. It talks about the greatness of God. Great are you, Lord. Would you sing with that? Every voice in the room, it doesn't matter if you're on pitch or off pitch. God hears our heart, I think. Amen? So let's sing to him this great song. Let him know how you feel about our Lord. Let's do that, okay?
You give life. You are love. You bring light to the darkness. You give hope. You restore every heart that is broken. And great are you, Lord. It's your breath in our lungs, so we pour out our praise. We pour out our praise. It's your breath in our lungs, so we pour out our praise. You only.
Amen. You give life. Sing it, church.
You give life. You are love. You bring light to the darkness. You give hope. You restore every heart that is broken. Great are you, Lord. It's your breath in our lungs, so we pour out our praise. We pour out our praise. It's your breath in our lungs, so we pour out our praise. You only. It's your breath in our lungs, so we pour out our praise. We pour out our praise. It's your breath in our lungs, so we pour out our praise. You only.
And all the earth will shout, great are you, Lord. Amen. Let's do that this evening. Every voice, let's shout the greatness of our God. Amen. Sing it together.
And all the earth will shout your praise. Our hearts will cry. These bones will sing. Great are you, Lord. And all the earth will shout your praise. Our hearts will cry. These bones
Stand with me again, a great hymn, Glorious is Thy Name. And let me just encourage you to do this. It's a time of worship as well. If you have an offering that you normally give on a Sunday night as the ushers pass the plate, we're not doing that in our service today. But as an act of worship, let me encourage you to do this. As we begin singing, if you have an offering or a tithe, you can come down and put it in our box down front, and our guys will collect all that up shortly. But let's sing this great hymn, Glorious is Thy Name. You may be seated. Actually, that's the wrong song. We could do that.
Is empty, no more traffic in the streets. All the builders' tools are silent, No more traffic in the street. All the builder's tools are silent. No more time to harvest wheat. Busy housewives cease their labors. In the courtroom, no debate.
Let's stop right there. Let's go back and do that again. We want to do it right, right? There you go.
The builder's tools are silent. No more time to harvest wheat. Busy housewives cease their labor. In the courtroom, no debate. Work on earth is all suspended as the king comes through the gate.
The king is coming. The king is coming. I just heard the trumpet sounding, and now his face I see. The king is coming, the king is coming, praise God, he's coming for me.
Faces line the hallways, those whose lives have been redeemed, broken homes that he has mended, those from prison he set free, little children and the aged, hand in hand stand all aglow. Those who are crippled, broken, ruined, clad in garments white as snow.
The king is coming. The king is coming. I just heard the trumpet sounding, and now his face I see. The king is coming, the king is coming, praise God, he's coming for me. I can hear the chariots rumble, I can see the marching throng.
Heaven's choir is now assembled.
Well, me and Billy Honey couldn't get you to say amen this morning, so I'm glad somebody could. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. David and Goliath, a boy and a giant, a stick and a stone. You know, we all like underdogs. How many of you, some of you here are old enough to remember the United States hockey team in 1980 against the Russian hockey team? They said they had no chance, and they won the gold medal. We all kind of pull for the underdogs. And this story about David and Goliath tells us about there's an adversary, there's an advocate, and then there's the Almighty God. And we're going to talk about that tonight in light of where we are. Now, the adversary is Goliath. 1 Samuel 17, beginning in verse 1, tells us about this adversary, Goliath. Now, the Philistines gathered their armies together to battle, and they were gathered at some of these places I can't pronounce, not going to try to, and they encamped there. And Saul and the men of Israel were gathered together, and they encamped in the valley of Elah and drew up in battle array against the Philistines. And the Philistines stood on a mountain on one side, and Israel stood on a mountain on the other side with a valley between them. And a champion went out from the camp of the Philistines named Goliath from Gath, whose height was 6 cubits and a span. He had a bronze helmet on his head. He was armed with a coat of mail, and the weight of the coat was 5,000 shekels of bronze. And he had bronze armor on his legs and a bronze javelin between his shoulders. Now the staff of his spear was like a weaver's beam, and his iron spearhead weighed 600 shekels, and a shield bearer went before him. Ladies and gentlemen, I submit to you that in this story of David and Goliath, it's obvious to us that the Goliath was the adversary. He was 9 feet, 6 inches tall. He had 126 pounds of armor alone. He carried a javelin, a sword, and a spear. He was a dominator and a dictator. And the word defy is in this text, 1 Samuel 17, is in this text 6 times because the reason David went against Goliath was because Goliath defied his God. And people defy God today. I'm amazed at where that defiance comes from. It comes from people that are lost and without the Lord, but it also comes from people that you and I might not think it would come from. But people defy God, and they're coming against God today, and I wrote down a few things. We have our biblical view that says that we believe in absolutes. Did you know the latest Gallup poll in 2019 said that 70% of the world rejects moral absolutes? We live in times now to where if a person, a man, a preacher, a teacher, a Christian, you name it, whoever it might be, if he takes a stand and says, "Thus saith the Lord," that he's looked at as being too hard, he's looked at as being condemning, he's looked at as being judgmental. Matter of fact, I studied something, and I read this, and I thought it was interesting. At a gathering of seminary professors, one teacher reported that at his school, the most damaging charge that one student can lodge against another is that they're being judgmental. And he said, "I found this pattern very upsetting. You can't even get a good argument going in class anymore, because as soon as somebody takes a stand on an important issue, somebody else in the class hollers out and says, 'You're being judgmental.' And that's it. That's the end of discussion, because everybody's intimidated. Many of my fellow professors know so. And there seemed to be a consensus that the fear of being judgmental has taken on epidemic proportions." He said, I quote, "Is the call for civility just another way of spreading this epidemic? If so, then I'm against civility. But I really don't think that's what it is. I don't think that's what's going on around us. Civility does not require us to approve of what other people believe and do. End of quote. Now, ladies and gentlemen, I submit to you that it's one thing to insist that people have the right to express their basic conviction, but it is another thing to say they're right in doing so. Civility requires us to live by the first of these principles, but it doesn't commit us to a second formula. Listen closely. To say that all beliefs and values deserve to be treated as if they were on the same par, that's to endorse relativism. That's to say if everybody's opinion has equal value, maybe that's true, but that doesn't mean everybody's right. There is a right and there's a wrong. As Christians, we stand for what's right according to the Bible. And relativism is incompatible with being a Christian. Relativism is incompatible with faith and practice. Christian civility does not mean refusing to make judgments about what's good and true. For one thing, it really isn't impossible to be completely non-judgmental. But the fact is, when we take a stand on absolutes, Jesus Christ is the only way to God. Jesus Christ is the only way to know happiness and to know joy and significance and peace today. Many religions don't teach what I believe and what we preach. Now, I don't want to be ugly because some people in this church that have pity-pattered around and left have said it's because I'm condemning. But the fact is, if you don't believe Jesus Christ is the only way, then I don't have a whole lot for you because Christ is the only way. If you're another religion that says we're all going climbing the same mountain, we're going to all go to the same place, I got a word for that, baloney. I don't care how you cut it, it's still baloney. I hope you're listening. It's still baloney. If a person doesn't turn from their sin and turn to Jesus Christ, you're eternally damned. No matter how hard you work, no matter how many good things you do, no matter how many times you've been baptized, no matter how many times you've got a Sunday school pen, if you didn't trust in Jesus, then you don't know God and you can't be with Him for eternity. That's an absolute that I ain't going to back down on. That's an absolute that I won't back down on. Relativism, they tell me that today only 32% of the world believe the Bible literally. And then I got to thinking about eternity. Most people today, the worldview is everything's just, if it feels good, do it. Get the immediate satisfaction. It's okay because we all do it, and you know what? What I'm doing ain't as bad as what you're doing. That's the worldview, but the biblical view is everything is eternal. There are three gates that lead into the cathedral at Milan. Over one gate is an inscription in marble under a beautiful flower bouquet that says, "The things that please are temporary." Over the second gate, there's a cross with this inscription. The things that disturb us are temporary. However, over the one central gate, there's a big inscription that says, "Eternal are the important ones." My biblical view also says that history plays a lot into who we are as Christians. Matter of fact, I'd break it down and just say, H-I-S, S-T-O-R-Y, his story, is big in everything that we believe from a biblical view. Everybody out there seems as anti-historical. People are anti-Jesus. You tell them you're a Baptist and they say, bless you. Y'all had a chicken supper lately? You tell them you're other religions, and I almost said some of them, and you see them at the liquor store and it's okay, y'all all right? They're anti-Jesus. We're not anti-Jesus. We're all about Jesus. Matter of fact, we need more preaching. I'm talking to myself out of this pulpit about Jesus. You know what? Because I have a biblical view, I look at the supernatural. I look at a supernatural. A woman went to get her cancer x-rays today, and she had cancer. And she went the next day to get her treatment and her cancer x-rays, and the cancer was gone. God did that. God did that. That person who gets on his knees and says, God, I need you to provide for me. And God, I'm praying that you'll prompt somebody or you'll provide in some supernatural way. And then the next day that check's in the mailbox. I'm telling you, that's supernatural. My God operates in the supernatural. My God doesn't operate in the natural. Matter of fact, I think God's offended when the church operates all the time in the natural. When we're called to be and to live and be in the supernatural. But the worldview says, let's be naturalistic. Hollywood has been inundated by the church at Scientology. The church at Scientology. We just had a big-time name in Hollywood, I'm not going to call his name, whose son died because he would not allow them to give his son a blood transfusion because the church at Scientology doesn't believe in that. The worldview says everything's natural. The biblical view is idealistic, while the worldview is pragmatic. Let's do what works. I'm telling you, that's the giant, that's the Goliath that we face today. Whatever's working, let's just do that. I believe the biblical view of religious liberty, but I know that the worldview out there is coming against religious liberty. Can we say it this way? You can't be a Jesus freak anymore. Because they'll certainly come against you. The adversary was Goliath. And we got an adversary today. And that adversary is here to make us doubt and question God. That adversary is here to make the wrong seem attractive. That adversary is here to make us put off and delay what we ought to do now. That adversary will get us to look at our problems instead of looking at God. That adversary will make us feel defeated and make us feel like failures. Look what you just said. Look what you just did. You ain't a Christian. That adversary is the enemy. It's Satan. That's the adversary. And there's adversaries that can be inside the church, and the adversary can even be our best friend. Be careful. But there's an advocate. Look what it says in verse 12. Now David was the son of the Ephratite of Bethlehem, Judah, whose name was Jesse, who had 8 sons. So here comes David on the scene. David, I said this morning. I think I said something about it last week. David was a warrior. David was a projectile warrior. He was skilled up to 200 yards with a stick and a stone. He could kill a bird in flight. The stones could fly at 150 to 175 miles an hour. And Goliath, the adversary, said to David, bring it on. And David said, come get you some, buddy. David said, I'm ready for you. I'm ready for you. And you know why I'm ready for you? Because I've grown sick and tired of you defying my God. I've grown weary of you telling me that my God can't do it. I've grown weary in America of people telling us on TV and even in church that there's no moral absolutes. I've grown weary of people telling me that God doesn't do the supernatural. I've grown weary of people that telling me that God's not bigger than me, that we've diminished God to our size so he'll fit into my box with me, and I can elevate myself as Oprah said. Yeah, I called her name. Oprah said, we're all gods. There's something inside of us, an electric field, that we can all go sit on the fence and talk to God, and we're on the same level with God. Makes me want to puke. No, that's not my God. That's not my God. And Goliath said, bring it on, David. Come and get me. And David said, you don't want none of this. And David gave his speech. And then we move over to verse 41, and we see what's about to happen. So the Philistine came and began drawing near to David, and the man who bore the shield went before him. So here we are, getting ready to bring all this to where God wants us to go tonight. We see the adversary, we see the advocate, and here's Almighty God. Four times, David referenced God. Defend God. Stand for God. Depend on God. Defend God's reputation. And the word is for us today. So now I'm going to make some statements for us. Number one, I made last Sunday briefly. It's time for the church to speak up. All right, I'm going to pull a Billy Honey. Surely somebody would say amen to that. It's time for the church to speak up. The church is too silent. And silence in the time of evil is evil. And not to speak is to speak. And it needs to be addressed. The church is not voting. We're skeletons in the do-nothing party. We don't want to get involved because we've become apathetic. We've become fearful. I used that word this morning. We've become fearful as Christians. And the nice thing about being apathetic is you don't have to exert yourself to show people you're serious about it. The nice thing about apathy is you can get a blank bumper sticker. They're for Christians who don't want to get involved. It's time for Christians to wake up and speak up and get into the arena. It's time we realize that the time is near. As somebody quoted me several times on the internet this afternoon. It's the author is about to come and step out on the stage, and when he does, the play's over. So why do we keep waiting and waiting and waiting? How many funerals do we have to go to before we realize that the sanctity and the importance and the brevity of life? How many church services do we have to come to and hear about the gospel preaching and hear about that the times may be near the end and we need to be prepared? When are we going to act? When are we going to stop sitting and soaking and act? When's it going to move from our head and our heart to our feet? And the Bible says we're kind of in this study. We hadn't been there in a little while. The Sermon on the Mount, the Bible says we're salt. That word salt, Matthew 5, verse 13, says it binds a covenant. It's used as a mark of friendship. It was a valuable commodity in biblical day. The whiteness of the salt means we're pure. We're to be pure and holy, that we're to flavor the world. We add flavor to the world. Salt stings. That means it pricks consciences. It creates thirst. Salt is a preservative. Christians are to retard spiritual and moral spoilage. Salt and light. We're light. Salt is hidden. Light is obvious. And it's light versus darkness. You've heard this before. You know what's wrong with the world is Christians that do nothing. No, it's not. Where in the world did that come from? That's one of the things that we've convinced ourselves in church like this one. We've convinced ourselves in church. I've heard this for years. The hardest people to reach are your family. Well, who in the world started that foolishness? The easiest people in the world to reach ought to be your family that see you walk daily and live for the Lord Jesus. And in church, here's what we've said. We got preachers that do what I do. People like me that say, the problem is the church ain't doing nothing. No, that's not the problem. The problem is the darkness has overwhelmed us because as light, we have ceased to be light. It's not the murderers. It's not the whoremongers. It's not the drug smugglers. It's not the child abusers. It should not amaze. Are you listening? It ought not to amaze us when a sinner sins. The light has ceased to be the light. And it's time for the church to speak up. Secondly, the Christian life is spiritual warfare. The world is attacking the Word of God. Goliath had great weapons, but David had the real God. Listen to the scripture. For though we walk in the flesh, 2 Corinthians 10, we do not war according to the flesh. For the weapons of our warfare are not carnal, but mighty in God for pulling down strongholds, casting down arguments and every high thing that exalts itself against the knowledge of God, bringing every thought into captivity to the obedience of Christ. I got a preacher friend. If this doesn't wake you up, something's wrong. I got a preacher friend who got on a plane and took a trip to preach. He went to his destination and he preached. And on his way back, he noticed two seats over, there was a man thumbing through some cards, and that man was moving his lips like he was praying. My pastor buddy said he looked professional. He had a goatee. He had some graying hair. He looked like he was probably in his 50s. So the pastor said, I really thought he's probably a Christian and he's praying. And I leaned over to begin a conversation with him. And when he leaned over to begin the conversation, my pastor buddy said, it looks like you're memorizing something. And the man said, no, I'm not memorizing anything. I'm praying. And the pastor introduced himself and said, well, praise the Lord. I'm thankful because I believe in prayer too. And the man looked at my pastor friend and he said, but I have a specific assignment. He said, what's your assignment? He looked at the pastor and this is what he said. I quote, I'm praying for the downfall of all Christian pastors. Do you realize the warfare that's going on? That our battle is not against flesh and blood, but it's against the powers and princes of darkness. And there's a battle going on. I don't know that I've ever heard a preacher do this, but I'm about to do it. You ever heard a story about the Alaskan bull moose? The males of the species battle for dominance during breeding season, literally going head-to-head with antlers crunching together as they collide. Often the antlers, their only weapons, are broken, and that ensures defeat. Listen to the story. The heftiest moose with the largest and strongest antlers triumphs. Therefore, the battle fought in the fall is really won during the summer when the moose eats continually. The one who consumes the best diet for growing antlers and gaining weight will always be the heavyweight in the fight. Those that eat inadequately sport weaker antlers and have less bulk. And I wondered, why did God put that story in front of me? Because there's a lesson there. Spiritual battles await. And Satan will choose a season to attack. Will we be victorious or will we fail? Much, hear me please, church. Hear me please. Much will depend on what we do now before the war ever begins. And the principle of the bull moose is enduring faith, strength, and wisdom for trials are best developed before they're ever needed. It's time for the church to speak up. It's time for us to understand that we're in spiritual warfare. But thirdly, victory comes through what the world calls weakness. Victory comes through what the world calls weakness. 2 Corinthians 4, all this is not on the screen. It's a lot. But we have this treasure in earthen vessels, that the excellence of the power may be of God and not of us. Verse 8, 2 Corinthians 4, we are hard pressed on every side, yet not crushed. We are perplexed, but not in despair. Persecuted, but not forsaken. Struck down, but not destroyed. Always carrying about in the body the dying of the Lord Jesus, that the life of Jesus may be manifested in our bodies. For we who live are always delivered to death for Jesus' sake, that the life of Jesus also may be manifested in our mortal flesh. So death is working in us, but life in you. And since we have the same spirit of faith, according to what is written, I believed and therefore I spoke, we also believe and therefore speak, knowing that he who raised up the Lord Jesus will also raise us up with Jesus and will present us with you. For all things are for your sake, that grace, having spread through the many, may cause thanksgiving to abound to the glory of God. Therefore, do not lose heart. Even though our outward man is perishing, yet the inward man is being renewed day by day. For our light affliction, which is but for a moment, is working for us a far more exceeding and eternal weight of glory. While we do not look at things which are seen, but at things which are not seen, for the things which are seen are temporary, but the things which are not seen are eternal. What the world sees is victory. We don't see it that way. And can I tell you tonight, church, because of Jesus Christ, we can be victorious, but there's no victories at discount prices. Victory only comes by a person who's willing to deny himself and take up his cross and follow Jesus. Jesus said, you must hate your mother and father. Let the dead bury their own. No wonder every time Jesus preached, the crowds got smaller. I read this, and it broke my heart. And then as I was reading, my heart went from breaking to rejoicing. Can you just hold on for a couple minutes and let me read this to you? Colin Chapman, in his book, The Case for Christianity, quotes a Ugandan bishop's account of an execution by firing squad. The day was February the 10th. It was in a place called Kabale. People were commanded to come to the stadium and witness the execution. Death permeated the atmosphere. The crowd was 3,000. I had permission from the authorities to speak to the men before they died, and two of my fellow ministers were with me. They brought the men in a truck and unloaded them. They were handcuffed and their feet were changed. The firing squad stood at attention. As we walked into the center of the stadium, I wondered, what would I say to these three men? How do you give the gospel to doomed men who are probably seething with rage? We approached them from behind. They turned to look at us, and what a sight I saw. Their faces were all alight, and they had an unmistakable glow and radiance. Before you say anything, Bishop, thank you for coming. I wanted to tell you that the day I was arrested in my prison cell, I asked the Lord Jesus Christ to come in my heart. He came in and forgave me all my sin. Now heaven's open, and there's nothing between me and my God. Please tell my wife and children I'm going to be with Jesus and ask them to receive him as I have. The other two men told similar stories, raising their hands while they could and rattling their handcuffs. I felt that what I needed to do was talk to the soldiers, not to the condemned. So I translated what the men had said into a language, and the soldiers understood. The military men stood there with guns cocked and bewilderment on their faces. They were so dumbfounded they forgot to put the hoods over the men's faces. The three faced the firing squad standing close together. They looked toward the people and began to wave, handcuffs and all. The people waved back. The shots were fired. And the three were with Jesus. We stood in front of them, our own hearts throbbing with joy and mingled with tears. It was a day never to be forgotten. Though dead, the men spoke loudly to all of that district and beyond about what the upsurge of Jesus Christ in your life would do. The next Sunday, I was preaching to a huge crowd in the hometown of one of those executed men. And again, as I was telling the story, the congregation felt the fear of death. But when I gave testimony of their man and how he died, there erupted a great song of praise to Jesus. Many turned to the Lord there. Victory doesn't always look to the world. Never looks to the world what we as Christians know victory to be. Statement number four, battles are won before the major crisis comes. David had a disciplined past. He was prepared for the giants. I'd submit to the church tonight that looking back in faith helps us to look forward in faith. During our devotion times on Monday and Thursday, I began this past Monday to look at some of the disciplines of our faith. We began by talking about abiding in the vine. And then we talked about praying in reliance on the Word. Tomorrow we're going to talk about praying in faith. If we look back in faith at what God's done for us, we'll look forward in faith knowing that God's going to continue to take care of us. We must face the fact that many today are careless in their living. And that attitude of carelessness finds its way into the church. Because now we have liberty, we have money, we live in comparative luxury, and as a result, discipline has disappeared. What would a violin sound like, Eddie, if the strings on the instrument were all hanging loose and not stretched tight, if they were not disciplined? In the 1880s, a young man who was an earnest Christian found employment in a pawn shop. Although he disliked the work, he did it faithfully as unto the Lord until something else opened up for him. And to prepare him for Christian service, he wrote on a scrap piece of paper these resolutions. I love these. I do promise God that I will rise every morning to spend time with Him. I will endeavor to conduct myself as humble, meek, and a zealous follower of Jesus. And by serious witness and warning, I will try to lead others to think of their needs as immortal needs. I hereby vow to read no less than 4 chapters in God's Word every day. I will cultivate a spirit of self-denial, and I will yield myself a prisoner of love to the Redeemer of the world. End of quote. That was written by William Booth, who later led thousands to Jesus and founded the Salvation Army. Church, it's time to speak up. The Christian life is spiritual warfare. Victory comes through what the world might call weakness, and the battles are won before the crisis comes. Amen. And I'm going to add this one. The battle is for God's glory, not for ours. The battle is for God's glory. Do it all for the glory of God. Dignity, honor, praise and worship, living in the Holy Spirit, do it all for God. Things in our lives that are being done that only can be Him. We leave tonight with this. In our beliefs, trust in Jesus. There are moral absolutes. In our decisions, trust in Jesus. Humanly, it might seem impossible. That's when my God does good. When humanly it seems impossible. And in our response to trials, we realize that the battle is for the glory of God. May God add, and teach us what we need for when we exit tonight. We got an adversary. But I stand with a shepherd boy named David that says, our adversary may have some really good weapons, but we have the God of heaven on our side. If we're ever going to see it, if we're ever going to see it, it's now. Not one more wasted day. Not one. Father, I pray tonight in the name of Jesus that you'll pour out your manifest presence and glory in our midst. We're a people that's hungry to hear from you. We're a people that need to see in greater ways how you're at work, so we die to ourselves, so we can live in the supernatural, so we can live on the basis of your story, Calvary, resurrection, live forevermore. Our advocate to the Father, the great intercessor. We need you like never before. Isaiah 66 says, God, would you rend the heavens and come down? Would you cause the brush to boil and to catch on fire? God, would you do it? Not for us, but for your glory. So there'll be a community that says, that's God. We love you and we bless you. As our heads are bowed and our eyes are closed, if God's prompting a decision tonight, and you're here, you can come forward now and make a decision. If you're watching, there's a number to call and a number to text. Please respond. please respond right now as God's prompting you. Pray for me. I'm hurting. I'm depressed. I need Jesus. Somebody call me back. Whatever it might be, reach out to God right now. Don't turn him away. Run to him. He loves you. Our Father, which art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come. Thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. I pray, God, tonight that our heads will lie down to sleep knowing that all we desire is for your will to be done in our lives right here on earth as it is in heaven. We love you. We bless you. Thank you for this day. Give us wisdom as we go forward, what to do, how to do it. Thinking about the preciousness of lives as we go forward. Thank you, Lord. And I prayed this morning, and I pray it again, that my thank you would not just be with my words, but it would be with a surrendered life. To God be the glory. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen. If you want to come and sit with me and Carlos, you can do that.
Unfold.